also Matthew chapter 5. So if you turn in the New Testament, the first book of the New Testament, which is the Gospel of Matthew, that's where we'll be today. We are going through a friend of mine's book by the name of Pastor Jeff Bode. These are the 5 assumptions about God and why we have them wrong. It's a great little book. If you want to pick that up, and you can go through that and make notes on it for yourself as well. The first week we talked about is that we need to try to work harder, or we need to try harder to make God happy. We found out that was not the case. The second week we found out that all God wants me to do is to go to church. And we found out that was not the case because even though we're pro-church attendance, the time that we come here is not about coming in to get a bunch of new rules and regulations. It should be about that time where we can come to grow together. We can come to fellowship with one another. We get a chance to see people that maybe we haven't seen throughout the week. So we should be looking forward to having that time together. I want to make sure they touch upon that because when we come to the church, it should be an exciting time. I've had friends of mine that thought that the skies were going to part and that they were going to be struck with lightning for coming across the threshold, and that has not happened, and yet they've grown and grown through their time, understanding that these moments are when they get to grow with one another and grow with the relationship with God. So today, we're going to talk about the third assumption, and that third assumption is very simple, and is that God will never be happy with me. God will never be happy with me. When I talk with people, this is one thing that they talk to me a lot about. They say, you know, these struggles I've had, these different things, it's like I just don't see how God can ever be happy with me. I put things, you know, on the back burner, I procrastinate, I just kind of go through the motions, I'm constantly stuck in neutral. A lot of the things I do are poor, and at the end of the day, if I were God, I wouldn't be happy with me. So knowing I wouldn't be happy with me, and sometimes I'm not happy with me, how can God possibly be happy with me? Well, part of the issue with that is because of what the church has done over the years. To share what this means, I'm going to share with you about a guy by the name of Sergei Bubka, which at the end of the day is probably not the most recognized name in the world. And yet in the mid-1980s, when everything was going back and forth between Russia and the United States in the Cold War, there was this little war within that war that was taking place, and it centered around the pole vault. And there was a Russian champion by the name of Sergei Bubka, and his goal was to get to 20 feet on the pole vault. But the problem is, at the time, they had barely broken 19 feet. And so, if you're someone who has never watched a pole vault, it's literally a guy's running down with a big stick, and then they jam it into a pit, and they push himself all the way up, and they go over top of this bar, and the bar cannot fall off, you cannot hit the bar in any way, you have to actually go over the bar, and then land on this mat at the bottom. And so it sounds like, what's really the big deal? And yet if you've ever tried the pole vault, you would find out it's very, very challenging. You have to be very strong all over the place because you've got to be able to take your body and hurl yourself in the air. And then on top of it, the key behind the pole vault is that what they found out is you want to go as high as you can, and you have to hover there at the very top to get yourself over top of it and then to drop straight down. And so there's times when people are doing it and they get all the way to the top and they push themselves straight up, and guess what? They don't go forward, they come backward. So now they're falling down anywhere from 15 to 20 feet, and there's no pad anymore. And they have to land. And then other times people go all the way through and they use the pole to the point where they go to bed and they get halfway up and the pole snaps. And they end up on the ground. It could be, I mean, you're literally taking your life into your own hands because guys have been stabbed and all kinds of crazy things with it. Well, Sergei Bubka didn't care about any of that stuff. And there was a guy that was going against him, and they were going back and forth, and back and forth, and back and forth. And every time one of them would break the world record, the other guy had to top the next guy. In fact, on one match one day, this guy that was his biggest rival actually beat him, and Bubka was so upset that in the same meet, he came back and broke the world record. So this guy broke his world record, Bubka came back and broke that guy's world record, so this guy literally held the world record for one jump. And that's the only time he held it for 20 years. Because Bubka was like, I'm going to work so hard, and every time I break that record, they're going to raise the bar. And every time they break that record, they're going to raise the bar. He set 17 world records in 10 years, which is just amazing. And every time he set a world record, they raised the bar. And every time he set a world record, they raised the bar. His last time, his last world record, he was over 20 feet, because that was a big thing. He broke the 20-foot barrier. He was actually an inch and a half over it. It took almost 20 years for another guy to finally break his record. That's how far ahead of everybody he was. And yet, continuing again and again to work harder, and then they raised the bar. And then he worked harder, and then they raised the bar. And they worked harder, and then he raised the bar. And many times what the church has done over time has done that very same thing to us. We come in and we have all these things that we want to do, and then all of a sudden we hear a message, and so this is something we have to go and work on. So we go work on it. And then we get that done, and so we go out and we try harder. And then they raise the bar. And so then we come back the next week and we work a little bit harder. What do? They raise the bar. And we work a little bit harder, and then they raise the bar, and it keeps raising the bar, raising the bar, raising the bar. And it gets to the point where finally you're like, you know what? I'm exhausted. They've raised the bar enough times, they keep raising it, and I can't go over the bar any further. I just can't do it. And so we do one of two things. We either give up completely, or we just stay right there and we plateau and we're fine. Sadly though, most of us tend to give up completely. We go back to being complacent. We go back to procrastinating. We go back and we're like, well, that's good enough. Because what's been painted before us is this picture that God is constantly, okay, let's raise the bar, let's raise the bar, let's raise the bar. And because of that, we get to a point where we realize, you know what? God is never going to be happy with me. I set the world record for the pole vault. I've set the world record for the high jump. I've set the world record for being good before God. I've been nice. I've been kind. I fixed this. You raise the bar. I handled that. We raise the bar. And the preacher kept sharing things about raise the bar, raise the bar. And I have done it so many times, I just finally realized, listen, God is never, ever, ever going to be happy with me. And so I just stopped. Once again, because of what the church has done over time, sadly, we have missed what it is that God exactly wants us to do. And because of that, because of us continuing to have the bar raised, we see God as kind of this taskmaster, and this puppet master. He's setting things up and going, okay, here we go. Good job. You got to here. Let's raise it. Good job. You got to here. Let's raise it. Good job. We got to here. We're going to keep raising it, raising it, raising it. And guys like me that stand up here share that with you. And you feel like it is a never-ending journey. And it doesn't matter if you're a teen in high school, keep raising the bar, keep raising the bar, keep raising the bar. It doesn't matter if you're single, raise the bar, raise the bar. Oh, you know what? I got married, raise the bar, raise the bar. I'm having children, raise the bar, raise the bar. I'm raising children, raise the bar, raise the bar. I'm raising teenagers, lower the bar, lower the bar. I'm separated, raise the bar, raise the bar. I'm divorced. Raise the bar, raise the bar. I'm divorced again. Raise the bar. The bar is constantly being raised by people that have taken God's word and they've skewed it and they've really messed it up. We're going to start in Matthew chapter 11 today. And I'm going to show you in Matthew chapter 11 today that guess what? It is not about raising the bar. God never intended to come to you or to me and to raise the bar. And so if you're someone today that feels like there's no way God is ever going to be happy with me, I'm going to prove that completely wrong. And it's not going to be what I say. And it's not going to be what I teach. It's going to be through the words of Jesus. And when we rest in those words, it's amazing the changes that take place from the inside out. Matthew chapter 11, starting in verse 28, is where we're going to pick up the story. This is Jesus, and he is speaking. And this is the final portion of what is this discourse, which we're going to go back on for some of his first sermons he ever gave. And the last words he says, by the way, it starts in Matthew chapter 5, and we'll dive back into it here at the beginning. It says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened. And see, what happens is we hear these messages, and what we find out is that when we hear these messages, sometimes we just get tired. We get tired of being kind all the time. We get tired of being nice all the time. We get tired of not making good jokes when the jokes are there in front of us that we could rip on someone a little bit. We get tired when we can't be as sarcastic as we want to. We get tired when we know something's wrong and then we stand up for it so it's right that we're the ones who get put down because of it. We get tired when we raise our game, we raise that level a little bit so that people can see God through it, and then we end up being the bad guys. And we get tired just from everyday life. We get tired of going to work 6 and 7 days a week and not seeing God in it. We get tired of going to school and hearing teachers talk about evolution or telling us that we can't live our faith. College students, we get tired of hearing the side that, you know what, there is no such thing as faith. And we get faith. And we get beat up with it over and over again. It's a constant, constant, constant battle. And because we don't put the armor on every single day, the true armor of God, we take so many lumps, we take so many beatings, we take so many fiery darts or arrows, that at the end, we just get tired. We just end up weary. And because of that, we realize that we have these burdens, and it's almost as if no one cares. I have this burden of being a good husband. I have this burden of being a good dad. I have this burden of always doing the right thing. I have this burden of being a light. I have this burden of setting the example. And then we hear rules like you shouldn't drink. And so I have this burden now of not ever having a drink. I have this burden of never smoking. I have this burden of living one life this way and living another life this way. I have it, and we fill in the blank when it comes to our burden. Hey, the preacher said, don't listen to rock and roll music. Preacher said, don't listen to country and western. Preacher said, don't listen to rap music. Preacher's right. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Oh, my kids are like,
amen.
All right. But the preacher says things and shares things, and because of that, what he is trying to do is to help us to live a better life before God, but we hear it as a rule, and it makes us tired. Because during the week we live one way, and then on the weekends we live another. When we come to church, we act two completely different ways. That is not what Jesus intended. So if you're tired, if you have burdens, join the club. When Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, that's you and that's me. We all get tired at times. It's okay. We all feel those burdens at times, and it's okay. Know this, you are not alone. When Jesus was speaking, he was speaking to the crowd. This wasn't a one-on-one conversation. So the first thing he says is, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. See, when we get so tired, we need to rest. When we feel the burden so much, we need to rest. When the world is so loud and so hectic, sometimes we need to just pull back and rest. And Jesus shares why in his next words. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. A yoke was there's two different ways that you could look at the yoke. A yoke was something that was very, very heavy. Carpenters at the time actually made these for ox and oxen. They made one side for one ox, one for the other ox, so the plural was oxen. Don't get me started with the whole fox and not being foxen. I still don't understand it to this day, but these are for oxen, so which is more oxes. More than one ox, okay? So the one side would be for the stronger ox, the other side would be for the weaker ox. And they would set it up for those oxes. Oxen. Ox on this side, ox on that side. I should have probably said this out loud before I did this. So the big ox would have the larger yoke on him, but then connected to it would be the second ox, which would be a younger ox. And as that young ox was going along for the ride, it would learn from this bigger ox, this stronger ox, this more experienced ox. And all that we do is literally walk straight forward, get to the end, turn around, and walk straight back. So the big ox taught the little ox how to walk in a straight line, how to keep the path straight. But behind it was the landowner, the guy that was literally making sure that they would stay straight. And what would happen is this younger ox would slowly learn, everything stays straight, we stay straight, we stay straight, learning from the big ox who was learning from the master. Over time, the smaller ox would get bigger and stronger, and they would change the yoke and make it a little bit bigger. And they would change the yoke and make it a little bit bigger until that younger ox got to the point where it was so strong it could now lead. And now a new yoke was built. And it was set up so that this younger ox was now a leading ox, and then it could do the same thing to teach a younger ox along the path. So when it's talking about the yoke, this is big, heavy thing that we would put on ourselves. We would have someone next to us, and we would then walk along the path to keep it straight, to help them until they were strong enough to do it on their own. And so when Jesus said this, he said, listen, this is how the yoke is looked at, and this is how everyone pictures it. But watch what he says here. He says, then take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and humble in heart. Take my yoke upon me and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. See, the other side, the way that the yoke could be looked at is this. A rabbi would go and choose the younger people that would be his disciples. And the rabbis at this time would take the best of the best. The smartest of the smart, the guys that could learn everything, that knew all the words, knew all the laws, that could keep all the commands. And so he'd go and take those, and they would pick the best of the best of the best. Because eventually, those guys would learn exactly as this rabbi taught. And then one day, someone would say to them, you know what? When I hear you, I hear that rabbi. When I hear you speak, I hear your rabbi. When I hear the words that you say, I hear your rabbi. And at that point, they literally have taken that yoke. They have learned from that rabbi, and the yoke is now upon them. And they've gotten to the point to where they could now be a rabbi. It takes about 12 years for this to happen. The disciples would kick in right around the age of 17, 18, and at about the age of 30, they would start to be a rabbi. You know who never did that? Jesus did. He started right at the age of 30. He went back and picked guys that are 17 and 18 up to maybe 21 years of age. And he took the guys that were completely picked over. He took the guys that struggled. He took the guys that weren't the best of their spots. He took the guys that probably weren't the best dads in the world. He took the guys that were failures. He took the guys that just couldn't quite get it together. They had already been passed over. They were the second hand. They were the leftovers. And he said to them, just as he says to you and me, listen, I know you're going to get tired, and I know this is going to be a burden, but take my yoke upon you and learn from me. And the learning comes through this. Take my yoke upon you, and you will learn from me, for I am gentle and humble at heart. So he tells us to be gentle and humble at heart. Are we gentle and humble at heart at times? Many times the answer is no. In this loud and crazy world, in this hectic, crazy world in which we live in, it's making us tired. It's wearing us out. And we're feeling these burdens. And so we're anything but gentle and humble at heart. It's too loud. It's too hectic. It's too crazy. I can't even hear God's voice. I can't even listen for God's voice. And yet Jesus is saying to you and to me, listen, right here, right where you stand, I didn't put an age limit on this. I didn't say how old you can start. I didn't say how young you are when you start. I didn't say you have to be in school. I didn't say you have to learn my entire word. I didn't say any of those things. I didn't say that you had to be a business owner. I didn't say that you had to be just an everyday worker, blue collar, white collar. I didn't bring any of those things. He said to the crowd, he said to each one of us, if you're feeling tired and weary at times, come take my yoke and learn from me. And it starts by being gentle and humble at heart. And you will find rest for your souls. See, many times we think about our bodies. And the older you get, the more you start to realize that your body starts to wear out. You start to realize that people bring up things such as surgeries you're never expecting to have. When you were younger playing every sport in the world, you thought, oh, that'll never happen. And all of a sudden, boom, it happens. Now as we get older, we find these surgeries taking place for younger and younger athletes. For a game that they've played, they've loved for years, and all of a sudden, boom, and they have to stop for a moment. Where do we turn to? We turn and we listen to the doctors and then we go through our rehab, but do we give this to God? Because Jesus said, he says, you will find rest for your souls. See, when we rest our body, that's a natural thing that we do. But when we're resting our body, do we turn to God so that we can also rest and seek his rest in our souls? See, God starts with the spirit and then he goes to the soul and then he goes to our body. Sadly for us, we start with our body. We rarely get to our souls, and many times we don't even pay attention to the Spirit. Jesus continues, and he says this, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Now that makes zero sense. We talked about the ox, and we put these huge yokes that are on you. It's a heavy yoke. Part of the reason this thing is so heavy is because it weighs them down, and the only thing they can do is to look straight forward. They can't look to the left or look to the right because if they do, this thing is straight and it's rigid in between, and then this ox would be able to do the same, and it can't happen. So they have to stay straight and on the path. They have to stay focused, and it is heavy and it is hard work. And life is heavy at times, and it is hard work. And it makes us tired. And there's many times that we feel that burden. We feel the burden of relationships that are poor relationships in our lives. We feel relationships from drama that we have. We feel relationships sometimes from friendships. We feel relationships sometimes from people that we're missing, that we wish were sitting here with us. We feel We feel all out weariness and burdens from our work and from our school and from teachers, and it never seems to stop. And the yoke gets heavier and heavier and heavier, and it weighs us down and weighs us down and weighs us down. How do we let that go? Because Jesus said, my yoke is easy. Well, that's completely different than anything we've ever been taught. Because the church said you had to act this way. And the pastor said you need to do this thing. And then you need to go and fix this. And we're constantly out fixing and working. And we get to the point where we realize, hey, guess what? We're going to raise the bar. I'm going to raise the bar. I'm going to keep raising the bar. I'm going to keep raising the bar. I'm raising the bar. I'm raising the bar. We get to the point where we're so tired, we don't even care if the bar is ever raised again. So we quit, or we just stay right where we're at. Turn back to Matthew chapter 5. This is the beginning of this exact same sermon. This is what's known as the Sermon on the Mount. There's also a Sermon on the Hill that you can go through. Chapter 5, this is the very beginning. And so what has happened is, Jesus, there's so many people that are attracted to Jesus because his words are completely different. There's so many words that they hear from him, they're like, that's not like any other teaching that we've heard. He doesn't keep trying to raise the bar on me, where I have to get better, and what are the things I have to do good, and I've got to follow this rule on Sunday, and this rule on Saturday, and which day is the Sabbath, and make sure that I do this, and walk 25 steps this way, and walk 30 steps this way, and wear this color, and what, all those things. And then pray loudly on the corners, and yell at everyone, and let them know that, you know, all this stuff about God. All these things that we've set in place. Jesus has the crowds before him. The crowds are before him. And he's going up and he realizes this is his opportunity to sit down and to share with them. Instead of just the one-on-one that he's accustomed to at this point, and he's already started the miracles, so everyone knows there's something special about him. The blind are seeing, the people that couldn't hear suddenly can hear, the ones that couldn't speak could speak, those that couldn't walk and suddenly walk. All these miracles are taking place. And he realizes, you know what? Now is the time I really need to sit down and share with someone. Not just someone, but all those that chose to follow. And so if you had an opportunity with your faith to sit down for the first time with someone, what is it that you would share? What is it that you would tell that person across from you? What is it that you would take from God's word to say to them, so that they would know that even though they're tired and weary, that they can find rest in their souls. That they're worthy of being loved. That they're worth being loved. What would you share with them? And many times, over time, the church has said, give them this rule. Give them this commandment. Make sure they're not lying and cheating and stealing and killing. Because that's what we've all been taught. Are those good rules to live by? Yeah, they're great rules to live by. So good that they got put in the top 10. Right? Written in stone. But see, they should come naturally to us. So instead of focusing so much on working on these rules, it should be a part of our everyday life and who we are because of whose we are. So here's Jesus, and he sits down, and these are the first words that he shares. Now, when he saw the crowd, starting in verse 1, when he saw the crowds, he went up on the mountainside and sat down. Whenever Jesus sits down, it's a teaching moment. It's a time you should be writing stuff down, you should be learning, you should be taking this all in. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them, saying. So now, guess what? This is our first conference. This is the first time we're all getting together. Everyone got their ticket? Did you get a punch at the door? Did you handle all these things? He says, we're going to learn so many things here at this conference. And so Jesus starts and he says, blessed are the poor in spirit. Stop. He didn't say, live by this rule. He didn't say, this rabbi said. He didn't say, it's discussed in the synagogues through the book of the law. He started straight off and he said, blessed. 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 He didn't quote anybody. He spoke from his heart. And so when you're sitting down with that person that you know is tired, and you know we're feeling burdened, and they're wanting to ask every question that there is in the book, and you don't know every answer to everything in the book. Remember, this is not religious material. It's relational. And you're never going to know everything. We had this discussion here the last couple weeks within youth group, and it's like, I feel like I just don't know enough to be able to share. You don't have to. One of the people took this into their work, and the person started throwing every single argument out at them. And I would sit down with this person after the, if I were to sit down with them and they threw all these arguments, I would throw even bigger arguments at them. Oh, you think about that? What about this? You think that's rough? What about that? Adding fuel to the fire? One way you could look at it, but the bottom line is, I need to show them a place to where they're not weary, and they're not tired, and they're not burdened, because it speaks to their soul. So Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Who here would want to show your best friend, the person that's not sitting next to you, your spouse that's not here, your children that are home in bed, who would love to show them how to be happy? Who would love to know how to be happy? Churches don't teach that, do they? Preachers don't teach that, do they? You've got 10 rules to live by, and there's another 590 or 620 behind them. We're going to raise the bar. We're going to raise the bar. We're going to raise the bar. Because of that, we don't know what to share with others. Jesus' first opportunity with the crowd, because you can take it to the crowd, you can take it to the person. He shares with them how it is to be blessed. The word happy did not come into our language until the 14th century. So back at this time, people would talk about, how can I make you happy? How can you be happy? How can you be happy? They said, how is it that we can be blessed? And yet this word, blessed, in our language literally means happy. Blessed equals happy. And so when Jesus is sharing these words in your terms and in my terms, he says, this is how you be happy. These are the things that you can do to be happy. So now let's change the word blessed to happy and listen how this changes. Happy are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You want to be happy? Be poor in spirit. You know that heaven waits for you. You know it. Yeah, what's it say in 1 Chronicles 19, verse 22? I don't know. I don't have any clue. What about that whole thing with the dinosaurs and it being in the Bible? What happened to them? I can show you some dinosaurs in the Bible, but you know, we'll have to have further discussion. What about this whole end times thing that's coming back and being pre-millennial, post-millennial, during-millennial, and the whole apocalypse and the four white horses and the red horse and the green horse and the plaid horse and I don't know about that stuff. I like horses. I mean, they're cool, you know. I went off in the sunset. But I know this. What really comes down to is this. There's something missing. And there's something missing within your soul. And we're so out following all these rules, these traditions, and the bar keeps getting raised and keeps getting raised and keeps raised that I can never, ever stay up with that. And if I can never make God happy, then I'm never going to be happy. If you want to be happy, just listen to the words of Jesus. Happy are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are those who mourn, for they will be comforted, because Jesus speaks to our soul. Happy are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. There's no one more meek than Jesus. Meek literally means I'm content in who I am, and whose I am, and in where I am in this life. Happy are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. I want to be filled. Fill my spirit. Fill my soul. And in turn, it will fill my body. Happy are those. Happy are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Happy are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Happy are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Happy are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people insult you and persecute you and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Sadly, that's where most of us stop. I'm all good with this whole happiness thing. Now I want to be happy when I walk into church, but I want to be happy when I walk in the world, and most of the time I'm not. And because the bar kept getting raised, there's no way that I can make God happy, so I'm just going to quit because I'm going to be persecuted. People are going to call me names, and people are going to put me down for walking in my faith. And it's going to hurt. It's going to be painful. And I'm going to hear those things. And I would say to you, that's because you're focused on body, and you stop there. Jesus is focused on your spirit and your soul, and your body comes along with it. It's an eternal thing. And yet he starts off this very sermon, his very first sermon ever, and he says, this is how you'll be happy. But he doesn't pull punches. He lets you know there are going to be times of turmoil. There are going to be times of heckling. There are going to be times of persecution. Those times are going to happen. Where will you seek? Who will you seek for your happiness? Who will you seek? Where will you seek for your soul and for your spirit? Because he gives us promise after promise in these words, and that's where he starts with you and with me. He's not raising the bar. In fact, he's doing something completely different. Would you turn into John chapter 15, please? John chapter 15. Those verses we just took were called the Beatitudes. It's how our attitudes ought to be within life. At the end of the day, what Jesus was calling for us, he is saying this: if you can be gentle and humble at heart, if you choose to be gentle and humble at heart, your life completely changes. Your life completely changes because of what God promises you. Not by what you know, but by who you know. John chapter 15, he says it this way, starting in verse 15. He says, John chapter 14, starting in verse 15. This is his promise. If you love me, you will obey what I command. If you love me, you obey what I command. If you love me, you will obey what I command. It should come easy. My yoke is light. The world's yoke is heavy. It weighs you down. It's around your shoulders. It beats you up. You can only look one way. My yoke is light, and the burdens are easy. If you love me, you will obey my command of what I command, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever, the Spirit of Truth. Notice what he brought. He speaks first to our spirit. He says, if you love me, you'll obey the command. My yoke is easy because it's not about following a bunch of rules. It's not about having the bar raised on you. It's not about knowing every commandment. It's not about knowing everything between in the beginning and amen. It's about loving and caring for others right where it is that they live. It's about being relational. It's about speaking to their spirit and their soul. And their body comes right along with it. When Jesus shares these words, he says, listen, there's way bigger promise than you can even understand. See, Jesus can sit amongst one, he can sit amongst many. But the Holy Spirit, he can minister to any one of us at any time. At any time. So it's up to us, it's our choice as to who it is that we turn to. Because many times we turn to ourselves. What Jesus is sharing is this. My yoke is light. Because all I've asked you to do is to love those that God brings into your life. My yoke is light because all we need to do is focus on being alongside of Christ. My yoke is light because even though I'm wearing this yoke, I already know that I am yoked to my teacher. So that when I speak about people being blessed. When I speak about people finding happiness. When I speak to them about being meek. And knowing that there's more to this life than just this life. And when I speak, I'm not afraid to admit that I don't know everything. That I don't have all the answers. But I tell you what, I'd sure love to dive in and find out more and share more. And if you get this right, all the questions you have among God, one day you can take it to Him and you can ask Him those questions. Because He's the only one that knows some of those answers. But in the meantime, I'm just going to love you right where you live. I'm just going to care for you right where you live. And I'm going to quit trying to worry about being happy and being happy and being happy and making God happy and making God happy. But I'm going to try and walk so that when people see me, that they can see Jesus. When people see me, that they can see the Holy Spirit working through my life. When people see me, that they can realize that the yoke's not nearly as heavy as I think. And the burdens, they're actually pretty easy. If you're someone today that feels like God will never be happy with you, know this. You're blessed. You are blessed. You are blessed.